My country, 'tis of me, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains' majesty, above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Swing low, sweet chariot, come and forth and carry me home. Swing, swing low, sweet chariot, come and forth and carry me home. I looked over Jordan, and what did I see? Come and carry me home. A band of angels coming after me, coming for to carry me home, home. Swing, swing loose, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing loose, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Oh, no matter what you may hear, we are one country. We all know the words to roughly the same songs. And so, no matter what differences may exist between us, which I'm not going to bring up tonight. Whoa, no. Nonetheless, we are one people, and we sing in four-part harmony. Well, she was just 17, if you know what I mean. And the way she looked was way beyond compare. How could I dance with another when I saw her standing there? Well, she looked at me, and I could see that before too long I'd fall in love with her. Whoa, 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 whoa. I'll never dance with another who, when I saw her standing there. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise as when we'd first begun. I've been working. on the railroad all the live long day. I've been working on the railroad just to pass the time away. Can't you hear the whistle blowing? Rise up so early in the morn. Can't you hear the
Right, you've got it.
Why not blow your horn?
What's the next verse?
Won't you blow? Why don't want you blow? Dinah, won't you blow your horn? Oh, 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 oh. Someone's in the kitchen, Dinah. Someone's in the kitchen, I know. Someone's in the kitchen with Dinah, strumming on the old banjo and singing fee-fi, fiddle-y-i-o. Fee-fi, fiddle-y-i-o. Fee-fi, fiddle-y-i-o. Strumming on the old banjo. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of rain, for purple mountain majesty above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved and liberty than life. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea, from sea to shining sea. Amen.
Well, I come from the big flat part of the country up to the north. Up there, all of you have heard stories, mostly mythology, about cold winter, but if that makes you feel better about your choice, that's fine. We're glad to go along with that. We have no poisonous snakes up there, and we have no amphibians that can run up to 35 to 40 miles an hour at a stretch. So there are many things that we do not have to think about. I come from a little town that's out in the flat part of the country. You stand there and you can see farther than you really want to see. You can see way down the road. You can see that nobody's coming to visit you, and why should they? I mean, you don't know anything they don't know, and for some reason they don't completely trust you. If you stand on a tuna fish can, you can see beyond the horizon, and it's a frightening thing. So growing up out there on the prairie in this magnificence that it takes you a lifetime to appreciate we grow up with this sense of ourselves as being very insignificant, which is not a bad way to start your life. We were brought up, this was baked into us. Do not think that you are somebody. In Norwegian, duske egetor, do I know it. You don't think you are any more important than anybody else. And you grow up with this powerful sense of inferiority, which which becomes an engine in your butt that moves you forward. You never take anything for granted. I grew up among fundamentalist people who did not see God in nature. They didn't see God in mountainscapes or oceans or any of that. I mean, we sang "How Great Thou Art," but we didn't really believe it. We saw God in the words of the King James Bible, and so we studied it verse by verse, sentence by sentence, paragraph by paragraph. And in this way, though you don't appreciate it at the time, you are imbued with a love of the English language that never, ever leaves you, your own language and the language of other people around you. I live in this house with four women in St. Paul, Minnesota, and I hardly get to talk at all. But words and thoughts go through my mind. You have to leave home for freedom of speech. But I live with these four women. The woman I'm in love with, who owns the house, and then our daughter, who is 18 and who has a lot to say, and then a niece and her 8-month-old infant daughter. And there's a baby daddy there somewhere, but but he doesn't say much for good reason. He is on permanent probation. I sit at dinner time among all of these female voices, and they're talking constantly. And as I listen to their conversation, there is no handle here for me to grab onto. There's no place in this conversation between women for me to say, well, that reminds me of something. Well, that happened to me once. There's no place for that at all until about 3 weeks ago. This is still so memorable to me. When somebody mentioned the refrigerator needed defrosting. We have this old refrigerator because I was brought up by stingy Scots, and the refrigerator needed some work, and finally I got my edge in. And I said, there were these three men who arrived in heaven on the same day at the same hour, and the angel of the Lord asked them how they had come to be there. And the first one said, well, I came home from work and I took the elevator up to the 22nd floor. I live in a condominium, and there was something amiss. I could tell the moment I turned the key in the lock. There, I heard voices, and I called my wife's name, and somebody screamed, and there were running footsteps, and I saw somebody else's sport coat there stretched out on the floor in the living room, and I ran in. My wife had locked herself in the bathroom, and I ran looking for him, whoever he was, and I looked in the kitchen, and I couldn't see anything. And then I went out onto the balcony, and I saw him, and he was hanging on to the balcony. He was naked. And I stomped on his hands, and he would not let go. And finally, I ran into the kitchen, and I grabbed the refrigerator, and I rolled it out onto the balcony. And I rolled it back and forth over his hands until he couldn't hold on, and he fell 22 floors down to the street. But the refrigerator started to go over, and I tried to pull it back, and I couldn't hold it, and it went over, and I went over with it. And so that's how I come to be here. The angel of the Lord asked the second man how he came to be in heaven. He said, well, he said, I came home from work, and I took the elevator up to my apartment on the 23rd floor, and I went to take a shower, and I was in the shower, and then it occurred to me that some workmen were supposed to come and repair the railing on my balcony. And so I went out there to see if they had, and I waggled it back and forth, and it came loose in my hands, and I went over with it, and I fell, but I caught myself on the balcony below, and I hung on, and then this idiot came out, and he was stomping on me, and he ran this refrigerator over me, and I couldn't hold on any longer, and I let go, and that's how I came to be here in heaven. And the angel of the Lord asked the third man, how do you come to be here? And he said, well, I was inside this refrigerator. This is not a funny joke in my house. Nobody laughed except the baby daddy, and he was quickly silenced. No, that's the house that I live in. But I'm used to this, to maintaining silence. I grew up among very taciturn men. These were Lutherans. Everybody in this town was Lutheran. Even the atheists were Lutheran. It was a Lutheran God they did not believe in, and we were all Lutherans, God's frozen people. We were modest to a fault, and truly to a fault. You gave us a gold medal; we would have had it bronzed, so that nobody would think that we thought we were better than anybody else, which was how we were brought up. These were men who got along pretty well on a very, very small working vocabulary. Oh, yeah. Every so often. Boy, that's quite the deal there. Yeah. Boy, what were they thinking? I have no... No, you could get by just with a few phrases in that town. English was a second language for those people. Silence was their first language. But I grew up with these people who believed that the Lord was in that book. And so, even though you rebelled against it, you learned, you memorized your verse every Sunday, and you studied these verses, you sat through long discussions of arcane chapters in Deuteronomy and Exodus and Leviticus. Leviticus is a book that if you sit through it Sunday after Sunday, it will prepare you for graduate school. You will learn a kind of endurance, and You will learn to wait for hours and days, you know, for something to happen that catches your interest. But from this, you learn a simple, primitive love of language, not the language of intellectuals necessarily, not language that is there to obscure the truth? Not that. You just learn to love language, especially in form. Language in form, which allows you to memorize. I grew up in an age of memorization. I'm not recommending this to you. I'm simply telling you the truth. That's all. My love is like a red, red rose that's newly sprung in June. My love is like a melody that's sweetly played in tune. So fair art thou, my darling dear, so deep in love am I that I would love thee still, my dear, till all the seas run dry. The devil came to church one day in a burst of smoke and flame. He ran up and down the aisles. He said, Beelzebub is my name. I am evil incarnate, the object of all your fears. The old man said, you don't scare me at all. Been married to your sister for 33 years. O daffodils, we weep to see you haste away so soon, as yet the early morning sun had not attained its noon. So gather rosebuds while ye may, for time is still a-flying, and this same flower that smiles today, tomorrow will be dying. A man walked by the insane asylum. They were shouting, 21, 21. So he went to look over the fence. It sounded like they were having fun. He put his eye to a hole in the fence to see what crazy people do. They poked him in the eye with a sharp stick and yelled, 22, 22. It's all just language. It's just all language. There's no great separation between these. Between these things, it's our English language. There was a time when grove and stream and every common sight had all the freshness of a dream and radiance so bright, though nothing can bring back the hour of splendor in the grass, the loveliness of summer flower, its glory soon is past. There was a man named Scraggs, bought 24 condoms a week. The drugstore clerk was quiet for months, but finally she had to speak. She said, what are you doing with all those condoms? It's simple, said Mr. Scraggs. I feed them to my poodle. Now she poops in plastic bags. It's just all language. It's just all part of our language, one on one side, one on the other. Had I the tongues of angels, and could I prophesy? And had I no charity, a sounding brass am I. For love is patient, love is kind, endures in truth and grace. And now we see as through a glass, and someday face to face. When God created woman, he gave her not two breasts, but three. But the middle one got in the way, so God performed surgery. Woman came before God with the middle breast in her hand. She said, what shall we do with the useless boob? And God created man. It's just a four-line stanza. It's just a four-line stanza. It's a classic poetic form. You grow up with these rhymes and you remember them. You remember them forever. Ole went to the neighborhood dance and he won the big door prize. It was a toilet brush and he took it home. And the next week, one of the guys said, Ole, how's that toilet brush? And Ole said, thank you, neighbor. The toilet brush, it works just fine, but I prefer toilet paper. You didn't like that as well, I see. You were offended by that. Okay, all right. I'll be more careful in the future. I'm not here to offend you or to extend your boundaries whatsoever. I'm simply here to say that the love of language, the love of words is something that we share in this country, regardless of class, regardless of politics, regardless of riches or poverty. We share this love of our language, and though sometimes we may be bullied into silence, and other times we may wisely choose silence, but we love this language, and it is what holds us together. You don't need to major in English to know this. In fact, you'd better not major in English if you want to know this. Wine comes in at the mouth, and love comes in at the eye. That is all we know of truth, for we grow old and die. I lift the glass up to my mouth. I look at you and sigh. These are basic to our understanding of each other. I have discovered what makes me happy, and one ought to discover this by the time you were 74. Other people discover it much younger, but I have finally concluded that what makes me happy is to have an idea in mind for something to say, something to write. This usually happens to me in the morning. I took myself off alcohol about 12 years ago, and that gave me my mornings back. I prefer mornings to evenings. I really, truly, truly loved gin and the feeling that you get from the first martini. But then come the second and the third, and that's where the problem lies. I had no interest whatsoever in sitting in the basement of a Unitarian church in a circle of folding chairs with other men and drinking coffee out of a styrofoam cup and talking about our fathers, none at all. And so my mantra was, the way to get something done is to do it. It's easy to stop drinking so long as you don't drink. So I got my mornings back, and now I have this wonderful life where you get up early and you do your stretching and you do your sit-ups and all, and you turn the coffee on, and to your mind comes this wonderful invisible thing that you may write today. And this to me is happiness. Whether or not you actually do it depends on other things, but the beauty is to have this inspiration. And this is something that anybody can have. To me, this is pure delight. I tried drugs very briefly. I had a wisdom tooth extracted it's been about 4 years now, and I went to an oral surgeon. I had gone to dentists before. I go back to the age of painful dentistry, when the dentist was there to carry out a kind of moral justice. And so you got in his chair, and he was an odd man with sort of pockmarked skin and odd hair growth, and his yellowish eyes were moving in opposite directions, and he would get right up in the chair with you, and pull out an ordinary pair of pliers from Ace Hardware, and he would fight you for that tooth, and it would come out, and your misery and your pain meant nothing at all to him. And now I came into this office of a very prosperous oral surgeon. He had a very expensive tan, and his hair was swept back, and he was wearing a white gown which had a double row of buttons, which was impressive. And I sat on a reclining chair, and lay there. And his assistant asked me, would you like a sedative? Well, sure. Why not? So they poked this little needle in the crook of your elbow and put in this tube, and you and the liquid, clear liquid, drips out of a bag on a tree above you, and in a minute and a half you are so far removed from this world of pain and suffering, this beautiful, dreamy, creamy feeling comes over you, and you sit there, and whatever these people are doing around you has very little to do with you. It's a beautiful feeling. You sit there and you realize this was what my friends were looking for back in the 60s. This is it. It was not in that black paste that they used to put in pipes and try to light the stuff, and the dry leaves that they rolled up in cigarette paper. That might have been that, or it might have been nutmeg, or who knows what it was. But it had no effect. But here it is. It's in chemistry. Is where it is. It's available to us if we wanted it. It's here, right here. They were done in about 2.5 minutes, and the nurse asked me if I was okay. I said, I haven't been this okay in a long time. They took me into a recovery room. Recovery from what? It's a beautiful thing. Now, I would not go there as a way of life, you understand. I was brought up to realize that chemistry is complicated, and you can never get the right dosage, and you don't want to go down that road. But I still have 3 wisdom teeth left. So there's something out there in the future for me. But that's not happiness. Happiness is being on the verge of something wonderful. The anticipation of writing, for me, the anticipation of writing something. I've had a very lucky life, and I've had all sorts of things that made me happy and gave me pleasure at the moment. I have held other people's infant children in my arms, and I have smelled them. I held my own daughter in my arms when she was only half an hour in the world. I flew on a supersonic plane across the Atlantic Ocean, all crowded in with a bunch of other people with way too much money, and we got over there, and it took longer for our luggage to come up on the carousel than it did to cross the Atlantic Ocean. I have canoed the Boundary Waters and Lake Vermilion up in northern Minnesota. I've slept outdoors looking up at the stars up above. I once canoed with my older brother on Lake Superior, and canoed in the Apostle Islands, and paddled deep into this cave, this beautiful cavern, and it had quartz growths around it. It was a low cavern. We had to duck to paddle way in. My brother was a photographer. He took pictures of the changing light inside this magical cavern. And then we turned around and we paddled back out onto the lake. And a minute and a half after we had left the cavern, the wake of a distant ore boat, a mile and a half away out on the lake, its wake came crashing into this cavern, one wave after another, slamming in, exploding inside this cavern. We would have been broken to pieces. Our heads would have been shattered. Our bodies would be drowned in this lake. We would be fed on by walleyes, but But we were alive, and when you escape death so narrowly, it makes you happy for a long time afterward, and it's a little strand of happiness that you keep for the rest of your days. I've had all these wonderful things that happen. I once shot a scene for CBS Sports in New York at a high school gymnasium that's on East 96th Street, and it was for the NCAA basketball tournament. And I was talking about playing basketball in high school, and I was dribbling a basketball, and then I had sort of planned this, but I didn't know it would work so well. As I was still facing the camera, I made a shot, a blind shot, over my right shoulder, and I hit a swisher, and the camera got the whole thing. And you could tell that it had not been spliced. It was shown on national television. I never saw it. I didn't see it. Don't care to. I don't worry about it. My Uncle Don saw it in Minneapolis, in southeast Minneapolis. My uncle saw it. And I finally, at the age of 45, won my uncle's wholehearted admiration. I became a star in his eyes. I've had all these wonderful things that have happened to me. I have owned a log cabin in the woods of Wisconsin and lived there happily. This old Swedish immigrant built log cabin. I have had a wonderful life. I was once standing on the 19th floor of the offices of the New Yorker magazine on West 43rd Street and waiting to see the editor, Mr. Sean, and my hero, John Updike, walked up and said that he liked a story of mine that had been in the magazine the week before called Zeus the Lutheran, that he admired this so much. To be complimented even briefly by your greatest hero in the world, who was taller than I, John Updike, was worth more than any prize that anybody could possibly give you. You put that in your heart and you carry that forever. I can think of so many wonderful things that have happened to me in my life, but happiness is there. It's there in the morning, the coffee cup in your hand, and you have this wonderful idea for something that you are going to do. And that is where happiness lies. You learn as a writer that nothing is ever finished, nothing is ever right. I did a radio show for 42 years, and sometimes I had to... Sometimes I had to listen to it myself, and I did, but never, ever with pleasure. Never, ever with pleasure. I loved the people who made music on the show. I loved singing with all of these tall, elegant women. I liked so much of it. I liked standing on a stage and saying it's been a quiet week in Lake Wobegon, and then launching into talking about the weather, and then finding your way to the Inkvists and the Krebsbox and the Magen dances and all. I liked all of that, but it was never, ever good enough, you see. It never can be. You learn to live with that. And the anticipation of doing it again, of writing something again, is where your happiness lies. I've been to London, I've been to Paris, I've been to Rome. In Rome, I once drank a wine, a Barolo, that was bottled in the year of my birth, 1942. And it was not a bad wine at all. And I was with dear friends, and we had a wonderful wonderful lunch. I look back on all these things with pleasure, but anticipation of what you are just about to do is where happiness truly lies. I got into radio in such a weird way. I went off to the University of Minnesota in the fall of 1960, and I had no plans to go to college because I wanted to be a writer. I knew that from the time I was 13, 14 years old. I had a poem published in the school paper when I was 14, and that was when I took the name Garrison. My mother gave me the name Gary Edward Keillor, but I needed something fancier as a pen name in a school that was crazy about football and basketball, not so much about poetry. And I looked in Webster's and found a word that began with the same three letters that means a place where soldiers are quartered, which was perfect. Perfect. A manly pen name for a sensitive young man who was more interested in Hemingway and Fitzgerald. Science never interested me. Science fiction never interested me. The dialogue just seemed so wooden. You know, we have to join our force fields together to overcome the power of the evil asteroid so that we can reach the astral plane of Clontarf, where the force of gravity is such that we will each be about 25 pounds and we will be like children once again. I mean, it's never appealed to me somehow compared to the dark heroism of Fitzgerald and Hemingway. So I never ventured into science and into those engineering exploits that might have led to the invention of the flip phone or Google and made me a trillionaire. Instead, I walked the streets of Anoka, Minnesota on a rainy night thinking about great novels that I would never write and longing for love, which did not come to me because I was in the Plymouth Brethren and we were not even allowed to dance for fear that this would awaken carnal impulses. It finally came to me when I was 18, back in the day when the front seat of a car was a bench seat, not bucket seats, and all sorts of things were possible, but we don't need to go into that. We don't need to go into that. I will just leave that to you. And no, I wanted to be a writer. Politics did not appeal to me at all. The rhetoric of politics, ask not what your country can do for you, seemed so wooden to me compared to and so we beat on against the current, drifting ceaselessly into the past. I wanted to be a writer, and so that was the course that I took. I tried to go out for football when I was in the eighth grade, and Dr. Mork put his stethoscope up to my bony chest, and he said, "You can't play football. I can't sign your permission slip because you have a click in your heart. You have a mitral valve prolapse." And thanks to this hereditary glitch, I then became a sports writer. And I got a job with the local paper, and I wrote sports, and I wrote it up heroically, even when we lost. I got to sit in a press box way up high above all my friends sitting down below, turning, looking up at me, waving, I, cool journalist, pretended not to see them. I wrote long accounts of the Anoka tornadoes and their exploits on the field, and I went back to the newspaper office, and I sat and typed it out on an Underwood typewriter and handed it to either Whitey or Carl, who were the two alcoholic linotype operators. And they put it into type. And on Wednesday afternoon after school, I went down to the basement and I watched them print the paper. And the pressman, though drunk, could stand on a platform with a great stack of sheets of paper, enormous sheets of paper, and lift them one at a time like you would lift a blanket and shake it loose and swing it up and lay it down on the flatbed, and the roller would come over it, chunk-a-chunk-a-chunk, and it would go down into the folder and it would be folded and trimmed, and there was my writing there on the last page, my writing, Garrison Keillor, my name in type to be read by dozens of people, by my aunts, my uncles. This is where your life is changed. This is where your life was changed. I went off to college. I took the bus down to Minneapolis, and on the way down to Minneapolis, late at night, as I sat in a left-hand seat about halfway back on a Greyhound bus, suddenly, as I was sitting there with the reading light on and reading Hemingway, suddenly I was thrown to my feet and there was a burst of light at the front of the bus, and we careened down into a ditch and up into a field and rolled for a ways, and the bus driver opened the door and I and others stepped out. There was the smell of fresh mown hay. It was late at night. Over on the highway, there was a line of headlights going way to the north and another way to the south. We walked through this new mown alfalfa and down the ditch and up onto the highway, feeling broken glass crunching under our feet. We had hit a car head on, and there it was, askew on the highway. The trunk was up, and there was a body in the back seat. There was the body of a woman lying in the middle of the road. A priest was kneeling beside her and praying, headlights lighting up all of this. Another man was lying and lifting his head and setting his head down, back and forth, back and forth. Another body in the ditch, the smell of blood, the smell of fresh new mown alfalfa. They sent another bus for us, and I got on it and got down to the university and could not sleep that night, and went off early in the morning to my English composition class. Richard Cody was the teacher. I walked into the class, and there was a girl reading the Minneapolis Tribune and the big headline on the front page that said, "Four die in bus car collision on Highway 169. I reached over her shoulder and I said, "I was on that bus." She looked at me, and either I was insane or I was telling her the truth. And she opted for the truth. Her name was Margaret Keenan. She's still a friend. She invited me to a party that night. It was a beer party. And she, her boyfriend, worked for the student radio station. And the radio station was holding a beer party on the bank of the Mississippi River. And because I had a crush on her, because she believed me, and she felt sorry for me because I'd been in a bus that had a crash with a car, I went to this beer party, kegs of beer. It was dark, of course. It was late September. There was a fall chill in the air, and we stood around a bonfire drinking beer, and a friend of hers, a girl, said, "Let's go skinny dipping." I found that to be a perfect idea. To me, it just seemed like the right thing to do after you had seen death up close, to go swimming naked with all sorts of people. And I and three other boys ran down to the river, and we took off our shirts and our shoes and socks to show that we were serious. And the girls were looking at us, and they said, "Go ahead, go ahead, we'll join you." So we stepped out of our jeans, and I don't know about the others, because you don't look around to check on people in this situation. I stepped out of my underwear, and then for modesty's sake, we waded into the river up to our waists. But the current close to the shore was stronger than we could imagine, and we could not stand there, and we were swept away by the current. Four naked young men swept into the Mississippi, and under the Franklin Avenue Bridge, this magnificent bridge, and then we came close to a rocky shore, and we paddled up onto it and climbed ashore. I was the first one ashore, and I walked up this steep slope, underbrush and gravel. It was hard on your feet. It was painful. I walked up in the dark, and in the dark, I was aware of men, a man here, a man there, a man there, a man there, standing around in this wooded area in the midst of a big city. I walked up through them, and one of them said, "What are you looking for?" I said, "My clothes." I kept on walking. I learned years later that this, back in the day, was a cruising area for gay men in Minneapolis. I came from a sheltered home. I had no idea what gay might mean or any of that. I made my way up to the East River Road and walked naked, quickly, swiftly, along the grass boulevard back to where the beer party was. Most of the people had left, except Margaret was still there. She was holding my clothes. She was weeping. She was afraid that I had drowned and that she had brought about my death the day after I had been in the bus crash. She was so happy to see me. Not happy enough, but she suggested that I should come down to the radio station and I could, you know, make friends with people and meet some people. And so I did. Like many student activities, it was understaffed. There were a lot of hangers-on and very few people who were interested in doing the work. I felt honored when they offered me the noontime news. It was a half-hour newscast, 5 days a week, and I walked in every morning at 10:30, and I edited from the AP Newswire a newscast and sat down and delivered it in a voice that was not mine, that I had learned from listening to Edward R. Murrow and Eric Severide and Walter Cronkite on the radio. I delivered the news in a little green room with green acoustic tile on all sides and a table covered with green felt and a big cardioid ribbon microphone the size of a football that was covered with foam. I sat and I delivered the news looking out a window towards the girls' dormitory, Comstock Hall, imagining that Margaret Keenan there on the third floor was listening to my newscast. That's all you need to keep you going. That's all you need is to imagine one girl listening to what you're doing. I did that from October through the middle of May, when our engineer, Harvey, a brilliant young man, having created a state-of-the-art control room and worked on it for months, then went out to do maintenance on the transmitter and discovered that whoever had done the maintenance the year before had turned it off. And so I spent 7 months reading the news to myself. But it's not the worst thing. It is not the worst thing when you are young and you're naive. What would be the worst thing? Would be to have no chance whatsoever. I loved it. I had so many advantages. I was so lucky. You have to get to be old before you realize how lucky you were in your choice of parents. How you could not have done better somehow. You were dissatisfied. You were hoping for liberal, intellectual, Unitarian parents, you know, who would have a drink before dinner and so on. But instead, you got these two people who were so in love with each other that they could not wait to get married, and they borrowed my dad's Model A Ford, and they drove off to a country road, and there my older brother was conceived. They did marry, and he was born in wedlock, but not far enough in. And this scandal horrified their families. Oh, they sat through so much condemnation, and this condemnation drew them together in an odd way. They were in love for the rest of their lives. They were married for 62 years. They had arguments about money, small things, but they were crazy about each other. And even in their 90s, they sat holding hands. They were in love with each other. To grow up in a house in which your parents love each other is a blessing you don't understand until you get to be much, much older. I was protected by the prohibitions of the Plymouth Brethren, the prohibitions against movies and dancing and what comes from dancing and all of it. You're protected from this. You grow up among people who expect Jesus to come tonight. And so you grow up with a feeling of this world as a very fragile, temporary place. And this somehow makes you the opposite of fearful. It makes you feel fortunate. You feel in the moment. You live in the moment. They gave you this gift. You were baptized entirely in Lake Minnetonka by a preacher named John Rogers, and he took you all the way down in this moment of powerful devotion, which in your adult life you will never ever feel again. Nonetheless, in this powerful devotion, you're taken out of yourself, and you look at yourself in a different way. It's not about you. You learn this. Everything good in this life is done by people who worked harder than they imagined they ever would have to, and they endured more boredom in the process than they ever would have cared to. Everything good that's been done in the world has been done by people who extended themselves to other people without being caught up in their own feelings. I'm getting into a sermon now, and I don't want to go there. Life is good. Life is good. You learn this when you're old, and you're done with all of your complaints. It's an amazing world that we live in, no matter what anybody says. It's a beautiful world. We live on this little well-protected island in a world of trouble and grief and suffering, but here we are, so we should be grateful for what we have. So much we have that we did not have back in the day. Soft butter. They mix it with canola oil or something. I don't know what it is, but you leave it in the fridge, but it spreads soft. We didn't always have this. We used to have hard bricks of butter, and you kept them in there lest you get streptococcal infections. And you had to scrape these shavings of butter off the top of it. And even though they were thin shavings, nonetheless, when you put it on your toast, which was Wonder Bread, there's nothing else. It was like tissue paper back in the day. Wonder Bread, you spread this butter on your, and it ripped it to pieces. And you felt that life was going to be like this. It was going to be one disappointment after another. All these GPS, what a beautiful thing. It was created as a part of our defense program, which many of you may have demonstrated against. Fine, good, thank you, but here is this invention which gives you this woman, I think she's Australian, and she's in your car and she gives you directions. To be given directions by somebody you are not married to. And if you don't turn left in 100 yards, or right, there's no recrimination. She just says recalculating route. If you don't get there one way, there's another way, you know? This is a great lesson in life, and we learn it from this little gizmo. So many good things in this world. We should appreciate each and every single one of them. Well, this is one good thing right here, is to be in a crowd of people who all know the words. This doesn't happen to me very often. I have gone to Lutheran colleges and tried to get them to sing, and I see a whole lot of 18 and 19-year-olds holding up cell phones, and they have Googled, "I've been working on the railroad." This is our fault. It's our fault. It's our grievous fault. We did not educate them as we should have. But there's something so wonderful about knowing the words. Oh, there was so much more I was going to say, but you know, it's all out there somewhere. You can find it somewhere. I wonder if there aren't some Baptists and Lutherans here. Might there be, or I don't know. One shouldn't ask and you shouldn't tell, but Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Big chorus, four parts here. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is love.
I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. Seen him in the watchfires. They have builded him an altar.
They have builded him an altar in the evening dews.
I've read his righteous sentence.
Read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. Our God is marching on.
Big chorus.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
He hath sounded forth a trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the souls of men around his judgment seat. Be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching.
He hath sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men around his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching.
Let's sing the last verse. You know them.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching.
Oh, it is usually sung at the beginning, but we've been warming up towards singing it at the end, and we just have to put it in the people's key.
Oh, say, can you see by the
we're so gathered.
Thank you so much.